A very good morning to all of you who are joining us for this live stream of our service today on the 3rd of May. So thankful that for our musicians who can continue to serve in this way, providing the prelude before our service begins, and also for the offertory. And I think there are some plans coming up in the weeks ahead that we'll let you know in time. Maybe you should keep it as a surprise, but so thankful for those who continue to serve during this time, own personal capacity. Thankful that you can join us this morning. This morning, we are going to be led in prayer by Brother Eric Yee. For Brother Eric, as our deacon for administration, he has been really solely responsible for keeping our plants and church alive. When this circuit breaker began, I was very concerned that that our plants be kept alive, if there's no one coming to church to water the plants, then they die indirectly because of the coronavirus, and we don't want that to happen, right? You don't want to come back to church and see all the plants dead. So he's been keeping the plants alive, checking the mail, and still doing a lot of administrative things, making payments and so on. Those things need to continue on. So very thankful for Brad Eric, continue to step up, and he's been really involved also in communicating and connecting with many of you as well. This morning, we'll be led in prayer by Brother Eric.
Thank you, Pastor, for the kind words. I think all glory goes to God. It is a privilege, to serve our wonderful Lord and Jesus Christ. So let us begin with a prayer this morning. Dear Lord, our Father in heaven, we thank you that this morning we can come before you to proclaim your excellent and majestic name. We thank you that, Lord, that you have given us this opportunity to be together, though not physically, but still we are able to gather together as one body in Christ through this online mode. And we thank you that, God, there is nothing far greater than to see each other with this ability to see each other face to face over this online portal. We are also encouraged that all of us are so enthusiastic to come together to worship you and to proclaim your holy name. Lord, we are so thankful for the many things that are still ongoing in Grace Independent Baptist Church. We have the Wednesday prayer meeting that's going on. We have the Ignite group that is going on. We have different smaller groups that is being taking place throughout the week. For example, we have Pastor who is doing this group with the young people and many others. We are thankful for the opportunity to serve alongside fellow brethren in Pasir Panjang Christ Church as we reach out to our fellow people, the individuals who are now isolated in the dormitories. We know that, God, these are ones who have helped us in many, many ways. Many a times that we don't see it. Help us, Lord, not to take for granted that these individuals are there. You have put them there to help us build the nation. And we thank you that we have this opportunity. We thank you for individual who has contributed both monetary as well as to participate in the English teaching class that is coming up very soon. We will have a meeting training this week, and we just pray for your presence to be with all of us. We also pray and thank you for the various ministry as well that is still ongoing, like K4T as well. It's amazing how, God, you have used this method to bring in 30 over children into this ministry. And we know that God, if there were 30 over children coming physically, maybe our classroom will not be able to fill them up. But Lord, with this online method, Lord, we can get all these people into one meeting. And we thank you for individuals who have continued to do all these for the glory of your name. Lord, we thank you that, Lord, that we have the opportunity to continue to understand better the need for discipleship. We thank you for pastor who have led us to the discussion last week, and there'll be one coming up this week. And we thank you, Lord, because it is your command in Matthew 18, 19, 20, that we will go forth teaching them, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Proclaiming your name, Lord, that is our responsibility. And we pray that God, that you will help us to be equipped to continue the work of discipling. And we ourselves are constantly being discipled by you. Help us, Lord, to have a spirit that is willing, the spirit that is teachable. And we thank you once again for this wonderful time that we can come before you to worship you in truth and in spirit. And we want to commit the word that Pastor Peng will be preaching to us this morning, that we know that these words will not return void. And we just pray that you bless his lips, and may the hearer, that you will bless our ears and our hearts, that we will apply these words into them. And we thank you, and we want to pray and commit this in Jesus Christ's most precious name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, brother. So we mentioned that got 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, that our mission, our purpose as believers is to proclaim the excellencies of the one who delivered us out of darkness into his marvelous light. And so our first hymn really is one that causes us to be encouraged to think in that direction, for the sake of his name, really based on Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20, as Brother Eric prayed. Once again, as a reminder that this time is no, there's no better opportunity than this season that we have to proclaim the glorious name of our Lord. So as part of our worship theme, proclaiming his name, let us sing for the sake of his name.
Lord.
Let's pray together. Father, we indeed are thankful for all that you have done for us in saving us. We are wretched sinners, undeserving of your grace in our lives. And Father, as your people submitted to your will, you have given us this mission to proclaim the excellencies of the one who delivered us out of darkness into his marvelous light. And as children of light who have received the greatest news anyone can possibly give, Father, I pray that you would help us to be assured that as we faithfully carry out this mission, that it is something that will be blessed by you. It is a mission that is commissioned by you, and you promise that you will be with us even unto the end of the age. Father, we think about those that has been neglected by our society, those that have been pushed to the fringes, forgotten, and because it is inconvenient to think about them. And now that the spotlight has been shining on these ones, we pray, we are thankful that you have given us opportunities to reach out to these ones. We pray for effectiveness. We pray that as we build relationships, you would bless that relationship so that eventually the gospel can go forth. Father, we want to pray for our church You know, in my heart, how dearly I miss seeing the folks here, filling the chairs as we often do. But Father, we also realize that the post-COVID-19 scenario will not be what we saw in the pre-COVID-19 scenario. Things will not go back to the same. Some changes will be needed, even as the government is thinking about reopening the economy and everything, society. Father, we pray you give wisdom to myself and to the leaders and to all of our members to know how best we can enact some changes to align to the mission that you have given to us, to mature disciples who will grow more and more into your image in word and in deed. Father, we pray for wisdom to create a pathway for everyone in Grace Independent Baptist Church, grow us to do so. Father, I pray this morning that you continue to be with frontline workers, medical, governmental, those in civil service, those in private sector, those providing essential service, in grocery stores, delivery. And these are now the heroes of our society. We pray that you continue to give them strength. The cases gradually decreasing. We are thankful for that. We have received news about how the government is slowly going to opening some services. We are thankful for that. That's great hope. For the eventual reopening of our society and our economy. Father, I pray that you continue to teach us through this situation. Help us to realize that tribulations and trials don't really shape us as much as they reveal what is already in our hearts. Those things in our hearts that we hit deeply in our hearts now bubble to the surface. These things that were conveniently hidden were because things were comfortable and we don't have to show our real self. But maybe now with this difficult situation, we can see maybe things that are not so pleasant that is being exposed. We thank you for exposing these things. We pray that you would help us to take note of these things and really learn by your grace and to be transformed by you in the days ahead. And so, Father, I pray that you will continue to keep us focused on you. There is no time where prayer and your word and being and just soaking ourselves in your word is more important than this time. It keeps us knowing who you are, keeps our hearts focused on who you are and what you have done. And we pray, Father, that you would continue to work in our hearts in a way that would bring glory to you. We pray for our ongoing evangelistic effort. Father, we are reminded that an of this very important task in our life is really tantamount to, it really is sin. Not doing what we know that we are supposed to do is sin as well. And so, Father, it is by your grace that we can do any of these things. We don't do them in our own strength, and we don't take any credit. If we do them, it is because you have helped us. You have supernaturally enabled us. So we thank you for these things. We ask that you will bless our services today, for it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right. The order is a little bit. I just after just seeing at him, I just felt so compelled to go right into prayer for the Lord to help us in these things. But our scripture reading this morning is going to be taken from Matthew chapter 5. And we are going to read the first 16 verses. You will know this passage to be the Sermon on the Mount, very famous passage. It is a great reminder of what kingdom citizens do. Where we are strangers, we are sojourners. That is what Peter calls us. So how does it look like if you are characteristics of kingdom citizens? We have national characteristics of Singaporeans. You know, we are known to be kiasu, impatient, busy, rushing here and there. All right. So what are the characteristics of not Singapore citizens, but kingdom citizens? All right. So we're going to read this passage together. Matthew chapter 5, beginning in verse 1, running on through to verse 16. Matthew 5, 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. May the Lord bless the reading of his words to our hearts. In fact, the passage that we are going to be looking at today in 1 Peter is really directly related to what our Lord said here. And Peter sat on those slopes in Galilee as he heard our Lord teach this particular sermon. And no doubt what he wrote, as we will see later on, is a result of what he heard our Lord preach on the Sermon of the Mount. Now, let us praise our Lord by singing this next hymn. Let the peoples praise you, taken from Psalm 67. There is so much that we can be thankful to the Lord for. And in seasons like this, we really need to discipline our minds to praise the Lord for who he is and what he has done for us. So let us at this time worship the Lord by praising his glorious name.
To shine upon us the brightness. of your face, so that your way most holy o'er all the earth be known, and unto every people your saving grace be shown. Oh, let the peoples praise you, yes, or the peoples praise. Let nations now be joyful, their song of thanks now raise, for you will judge the
at this time, we are going to be collecting the offering well, in a virtual way. So thankful to you, many of you who have contributed generously during this time, and that you have adapted to a new way to give, which we have to adjust very quickly to get this the PayNow transaction in place. The ministry of the church continues because the ministry of the church is continued by you, and as you minister to one another. And also very thankful for many of you who have given to the dormitory project. And later on, we'll kind of explain a little what is going to be happening, what's going on with this project. As Brother Eric prayed, now we are going to be moving to the training phase. And so the funds that you give will come in handy as we will talk about how those will be distributed. As you know, a week ago, we distributed the first $3,600 for the distribution of disinfectants, as well as the purchase of bottles to divide the hand sanitizers into, as well as the transportation fees that go into this effort. So very thankful for your giving, and we please continue to give as the act of worship. At this time, we have the offertory. Thank you so much, Grace, for providing the offertory for today. The prelude this morning, I think, was given by Elizabeth Fong. So very thankful for your continued service to the Lord and contributing to the service this morning. Let's sing our final hymn before the message this morning, Rescue the Perishing. Do we have eyes to see that there's a lot of people that are lost and dying and going to hell this morning? They're all around us. And maybe we don't see them because we are not interacting with them. We are keeping our social distance. We are at home. But may the Lord just kind of remind us and give us a burden that these people are all over us. Some of them live in your very own home. The Lord Jesus Christ died for them, and He desires for us to reach out to them with the gospel. Sometimes it's hard to reach out to your own family members, but maybe during this extraordinary time, the Lord will give you the courage to open your mouth and really compel your family members and your loved ones, those around you, to Christ. So let's sing Rescue the Perishing.
Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Weep o'er the erring one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Though they are slighting Him, still He is waiting, waiting the penitent child to receive. Plead with them earnestly, plead with them gently, He will forgive if they only believe. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Down in the human heart, crushed by the tempter, feelings like merit that grace can restore. Touched by a loving heart, wakened by kindness, chords that were broken will vibrate once more. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Rescue the perishing, duty demands it, strength for thy labor the Lord will provide. Back to the narrow way, patiently win them, tell the poor wanderer a Savior has died. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save.
If you turn your Bibles back to 1 Peter chapter 2, and I want to really orientate you, if you are joining us for the first time via live stream, whether it's on Zoom or on YouTube, we want to welcome you. But I want to begin by letting you know that we have an ongoing series in the book of 1 Peter, and that actually with the conclusion of our previous message in verse 10, we have concluded the first major section in the book of 1 Peter. So this is just by way of orientating you to know where we are. Okay, so what is the first section about? Well, it is about living inwards as pilgrims. We talk about how we are pilgrims, exiles, strangers, heading for our ultimate home that is not in this world. We talk about exhortations in position, in sobriety, confidence, holiness, and the fear of the Lord, loving one another fervently out of a pure heart, laying aside, feeding on the word, and fleshing out our new identity as living stones. And as we have seen last week, chosen generation, royal priesthood, holy nation, and a peculiar people, people of God's special choosing. So that is about who we are on the inside. But now, looking at the next section about living outwardly as pilgrims. And as you can see, this will actually comprise of the majority of the book of 1 Peter. 1 Peter has 5 chapters. And you can see from verses from chapter 2, verse 11, all the way to chapter 4, verse 6, is about living outwardly as pilgrims. From our relationship with one another, believing world. Okay, now let's put this on the table so that we have the same expectation. The world is suspicious. The world is hostile to believers. And in a sense, we saw hints of this rejected stone, you know, the chief cornerstone, not than the master. Why should we expect better treatment if they as well? So this section today, as we look at, will begin in verse 11. So I'm not sure you're going to draw a line from verse 11 all the way down to chapter 4, verse 6, with the heading, living outwardly as pilgrims. But let me just read verses 11 and 12, which is what the passage that we are considering this morning. Peter says, "Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul, having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they shall see, glorify God in the day of visitation." So these two verses that we are going to be looking at today function as the theme for this next major section of living outwardly as pilgrims. Okay? So believers should conduct themselves honorably as strangers and pilgrims. We see that in verse 11. In this world, so that unbelievers will observe their godly behavior and glorify God by coming to faith in Christ, which is a way of summarizing this section. Once again, believers conducting themselves honorably as strangers and pilgrims in this world, so that unbelievers will be able to observe, see their godly behavior and their good works, and thereby glorifying God by coming to faith in Christ. So, what do we have installed in the next few weeks in this section? Well, first of all, we'll see that Peter is going to be talking about our relationship to our government. Government. All right. And then, secondly, to our employment. Chapter 2, verse 13 to 17. All right, there we have the first one, government. And then chapter 2, verse 18 to 25 will be our employment. And then in chapter 3, verse 1 to 7 will be on the home, on husbands and wives. And then chapter 3, verse 8 to 22 on askers, unbelievers who are asking you, why are you so different? So that we are getting to. We want them to see that the way we live is so different from the way they live. The things that we love are so different from the things that they love. They will ask us of the hope that is within us. That is what chapter 3, verse 15 says. So the point is living out the distinct holy life in all these spheres of our lives, and there is no such thing, therefore, as a private Christian. Your Christian testimony is seen in your public, what we call our civic life, our work life, our home life. All right, we do not become a Christian on Sunday and then live like anybody in the world from Monday to Saturday. You know, if you're you're a business person, you cheat just like other people cheat. You know, you lie just like other people lie, and so on. No. Honorable conduct, distinct, holy living, 24/7, every day, whether you're at home, at school, in the military camp, or at your workplace. All right, we don't take a holiday, you know, from being a Christian. We don't. There's no circuit breaker from being a Christian. You continue to be a Christian. And Peter and the Holy Spirit shows us specifically how each aspect of our lives ought to be lived out. So, I want to begin this our examination of this next major section by reading to you a very sobering description of modern-day Christianity. Guess who wrote this, okay? So I have here, it is a screenshot. I took it right off from the website. It says this: at this point in history, evangelicals resemble the Israelites at various dangerous moments in the Old Testament. They are blending into the surrounding heathen culture and having even more trouble figuring out where it ends and where they begin. In politics and in business, they have mostly gone ahead and joined the existing networks. With pop culture, they have instead created their own enormous parallel universe. So the pop culture of the world, pop culture of Christianity, a Christian can now buy books, movies, music, and anything else lowbrow, all right, which is, you know, it's like kind of very borderline, you know, things, you know, you're kind of straddling between what is right and wrong, to middlebrow, tailor-made for his or her sensibilities. Were it that popular culture leads people, and especially teenagers, astray, the Christian version is designed to satisfy all the same needs in a cleaner form. Can you guess? You may not know who specifically wrote this article. Do you think it is written by a fundamentalist preacher warning against worldliness? No, this description is not by a Christian. In fact, not by a conservative Christian. It's not even by a Christian, you know, a middle down the road Christian or even a leftist Christian. It's written by an atheist named Hannah Rosen. In her article on a very liberal website called Slate, is an observation about Christianity by an atheist. If an atheist can see what is happening in Christianity today, and she wrote this piece 12 years ago, you know, how come Christians have no eyes to see where we have been and where we are going? What is happening? You know, it almost seems like the one that is a parallel pop Christian culture. So the world has this thing, let's have a parallel of this in our Christian, because we don't want to miss out on what the world is having, but let's clean it up and all that, you know, let's add a few Jesus into those pop songs and so on, and call it Christian music. An unbeliever, a hardened atheist, and Hannah Rosen has, you know, she's a thoughtful thinker. She's written for a lot of these kind of think tank pieces and so on. The unbelievers are observing Christians' enamoration with the world, you know, and its sentimentalities, and what she's saying here is that, you know, Christians are creating cheap knockoffs of what the world has. All right, it suits Christian sentimentalities, but eventually, she said in this piece that Christians are actually going to go for the real stuff. They're going to leave this cheap parallel knockoff. They're going to go to the real stuff. You know, they're going to leave this cheap Christian pop stuff and they're going to go to the real stuff. You know why? Because the real stuff is even better. You know, we have, you know, these Christian movies and so on, they are kind of cheesy sometimes and, you know, they are cheap production and all that. Well, why go for that? You know, Hollywood is much better. Hollywood spent $50 million on this movie. You know, this Christian spent like, you know, $50,000, you know, on this movie made with their handphones, that kind of thing. All right? This describes our Christianity today. It is absolutely against what Peter says Christianity ought to be. Listen to 19th century Scottish preacher Alexander McLaren says this, quote, "The world takes its notions of God, most of all, from the people who say that they belong to God's family. They read us a great deal more than they read the Bible. They see us, but they only hear about Jesus Christ." All right, so I trust that with this quote, you'll realize that, you know, it's very related to what we're talking about here. They will not read the Bible, they will not see Jesus, they will see you and Jesus living in through you. All right, so let's begin by noticing how Peter describes us. He says, first of all, that we are beloved. He calls, you know, his readers dearly beloved. It is a warm way to address the readers. You all, from time to time, dearly beloved. And first of all, we see that believers, first of all, beloved by God. We have been, 1 verse 6 tells, accepted in the beloved. No condemnation for them who are in Christ Jesus. Romans 1 verse 8. We have been reconciled by Christ with God. But secondly, because by God, believers love one another. Born again in God's family. Christ. Love showed us can be extended by believers to other believers, which is why it's important that you continue to show care and concern, especially to those in the household of God. Calling one another, I think, is a wonderful way to hear the human voice, you know, to hear the human inflection. If you can, you know, you can, I think, WhatsApp, you can also do a video call on WhatsApp. It's just one-on-one. We do Zoom here because, you know, WhatsApp don't have the capability for us to be able to Zoom video conference this to everybody. All right, but if it's just one-on-one, you know, to see each other and all that, it's a wonderful thing. And as believers, that's what we want to do. You know, if during this COVID-19 and you do not miss one another, something is wrong. Something's not right. You know, you need to ask yourself, you know, am I truly safe? I mean, I don't know. I mean, because believers just instinctively want to care for one another. They want to pray with one another, which is what I do. When I call people, I pray with them. And so on. So God calls us his beloved, and we can call one another dearly beloved. But the second thing I want to note here is that Peter says that we are strangers and pilgrims. Strangers and pilgrims. You see that in verse 11. Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims. Well, what are strangers and pilgrims? Peter uses two terms to describe Christians, strangers and pilgrims. And both of these terms are synonymous. He already used the second term in chapter 1, verse 1, which says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Asia Minor. All right? And now he uses an additional term to refer to someone who is residing temporarily in a location, a sojourner. All right? And so that is what you do. All right? When you rent an Airbnb or book a hotel, these are temporary lodging. So this description is of Abraham. Abraham was also a sojourner. And as we spend time, you know, looking at the biblical theology of sojourning in the Bible that we did when we first started this book, we see, you know, children of Israel also journeyed in from, you know, Egypt into into the promised land. Okay, so they are sojourners. So that's what the first thing is. What are strangers and pilgrims? Well, we are, you know, we are sojourners. We are living in this place. It's a temporary dwelling, okay, for all of us. So then there's another term that Peter uses. The first term translated strangers here, and this term refers to someone who is a resident foreigner. It is when, you know, you go overseas, okay, you rent a hotel, you book a hotel, you rent an Airbnb to stay in, which are, you know, so there you have it, Airbnb, maybe there's a picture of a hotel there somewhere, there you go. So this particular hotel at the bottom there was where we stayed, when we were in Taiwan, back in January. It seems like we were there about 18 years ago. That was how long, that's how much things have changed since January, okay? And you see Jonas in the Old Testament, the children of Israel, and that is what they do. All right. So, but here's another way of thinking about it. Here's the passport. Imagine someone with let's say citizenship in Singapore. We don't have citizenship, but some countries allow dual citizenship. And one day he is suddenly told that both citizenships only have temporary validity. All right. Where will he go if both countries reject him? You hear stories of individuals in this world with no citizenship anywhere. You talk about some displaced people in the world. The Rohingyas, you know, they are rejected by Myanmar, but they cannot go anywhere. They are stateless people. Now, as Christians, think of yourself this way. When it comes to your place in this world, think of yourself as stateless. All right? Think of yourself as living in a very temporary location. All right? This world is not our home. Our home eventually is in, our citizenship is in heaven. Now, what makes us strangers and pilgrims? These two terms really shouldn't be distinguished too much. Peter is piling on synonyms to drive home this point about who we are. What makes us foreigners and strangers is our citizenship is in heaven. Our allegiance is to Christ. This world is only a temporary residence for us. It is not our true home. And so, for the readers of Peter's day, it is because of their status as Christians that they are experiencing hostility and suffering in the world. Remember, Peter is writing to persecuted Christians. They are suffering. Why? Because of their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, because they are proclaiming Christ. And last week, Peter assures them, remember your identity. You are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. You're a holy nation. You're a peculiar people. Remember who you are. Remember your identity. And then remember your mission. Your mission is to proclaim the excellency of the one who have called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. All right? So he's reminding them of these things. And because, you know, if you are persecuted for giving the gospel, well, guess what you may be tempted to do? Not to give the gospel, right? You may be say, well, let's just, you know, why are we so, you know, maybe they think that I'm a religious fanatic and a religious nut and all that, you know, so let me just keep quiet for a little bit. And Peter is saying, no, don't do that. Don't keep your mouth closed. Continue to give the gospel. Here is a picture of, you may not know who this person is. His name is, the man in the foreground, his name is Nkaye Waldani tribe, Ecuador. He murdered the man behind him with the beard, his father. Minkaye of the Waldani tribe murdered the man in the background, his father, in 1954. You know who he is? He is Nate Saint. And together with these men, all right, who were killed because this man trying to reach out to this tribe in Ecuador. Saint, you can see the, you know, the fourth from the left is Nate Saint. Six to Jesus, it is came to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you can read about it. I will encourage you to do so more time during this season. Elizabeth Elliot's wonderful book, Through Gates of Splendor. Wonderful, wonderful, uplifting account of men who have love for you know, these people who were very hostile to the outside world, who used spears. And you know what? These men had firearms in their planes. They chose not to use them. But these men gave of their life because generations later, Minkaye would be a Christian leader in his tribe, and many in his tribe would come to know our Lord Jesus Christ. Joshua, go back to the picture again. Minkaye died this last Tuesday. He was maybe 88 to 91. Back then, they don't keep birthdays. You know, this is an illiterate tribe. So he's about that age, you know, late 80s. All right, he died, but God has used him to give the gospel not only to his tribe, also traveled, I think, in the United States to give the gospel, to give his testimony. He was a murderer of Steve Saint's father, and Steve Saint said of him, I read earlier this week that Minkaye is like a father to him. Remember, Steve Saint lost his father. Minkaye killed the father. And what an amazing thing to see, you know, forgiveness and a true love for your father's murderer. All right? But what an amazing thing the Lord has done. And once again, if you think about it, persecution is not always a bad thing. It causes us to focus on our eternal home rather than on things of this life. The problem with material prosperity that, as Christians, as Singaporeans, many of us experience, is that it causes us to focus on material comforts of this world. Houses and cars and stuff. You know, we talk about with one another, what car should we buy? What house should we buy? What, you know, and what is the latest gadget we should get, and so on. And focus on those things. Well, that is what it talks about. The world on. It is up from, you know, one to the next thing, to the next thing, and so on. Focus on those things long enough and you start to think that your best life must be lived in the here and now. That is how unbelievers think. You know, they need to amass on themselves wealth in this life because the next life will be terrible for them. All right? So we need to think very differently from the way the world thinks. Unbelievers are scared to die because that's where the nightmare begins. Their best life is lived right now. Christians, on the other hand, think the opposite. Their best life is lived in eternity where there's no pain and there is no limitations on their body. There's no flesh. We'll talk about that later on, that they have to deal with. All right? So once again, this world is full of suffering and pain. This is life in the fallen world. This is not your best life now. You know, we are unbelievers are so scared of how to die. You know, they don't want to through a long bout of disease when they die, and so on. But you know, as Christians, you know, die well. They are confident of where they will go. They do not regard their life as their own. They regard it as their Lord. So once again, this morning, have not called upon the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. He has a much better plan for you than you think. He has a great mission for you that we looked at last week. You can be a child of God by calling on Him and repenting of your sins and asking Him to save you. Because of what He has done for you on the cross, shedding His blood on the cross for your sake. Now, how should believers live this life? Peter will answer this question using a negative expression and then a positive one. Now, he's going to say this, having your conversation honest. I, out of curiosity, looked up this word conversation in the online. Here is the Merriam-Webster dictionary that gives you the definition of what the word conversation means. And look at the red box there. All right. I think the box got shifted. But the red box should actually go under the, should actually circle the last line there of obsolete. You see the word obsolete there? That's what the red box should be, but I'm not sure why it moved. Conduct and behavior. The word conversation actually means conduct and behavior, but notice how this word is this meaning is obsolete in the Merriam-Webster dictionary. All right, so sorry, you know, the box should, it was the right thing, but I'm not sure why it got shifted. But anyways, the word I want to highlight it to you is this word that we still use today doesn't mean what it used to mean, conduct or behavior in 1611. This is what we call a false friend. If you are a new believer and you pick up a King James Bible and you read those words, what is the first thing that will come to your mind when you read conversation? Well, conversation means, you know, what talk, you know, exchange of words and so on, right? That's conversation. All right. And you fail to actually understand that, no, that is not what that word means. Back in 1611, it actually means your conduct and behavior. All right. So that is why a modern day translation is helpful, you know, to you to pick out these false friends. False friends are words that we still use today, but the meaning changed. All right. If it is no, and the word is totally obsolete, we don't even use it anymore, no problem. But when a word is still used today and we think we know what it means, all right, it actually doesn't. I have a friend, Mark Ward, who has made a series of videos that I've linked to on my Facebook. You can check out those videos. He talks about a series of false friends, all right, and you can enlighten yourself if you enjoy using the King James. Really, it's not the King James translator's fault. They are using a word that was in use during that time. But my point is, the English language changes. A living language continues to change. We continue to add words to our vocabulary. We continue to add words, and meanings of words change. All right. The word salty back in the day means, you know, it tastes of salt. But today we don't use the word salty in that way anymore. You know, it means someone is annoyed and all that. Okay, so if you are not aware of how that word salty has changed meaning, you need to be. Words change meaning, and new words continue to be added into our vocabulary because, the English language is a language that is alive, continues to evolve. All right, so take note of that. All right, so now. What Peter is going to say is that in terms of our manner of conduct, to abstain from fleshly lusts. He beseeches us, he strongly urges us. It's a strong exhortation to abstain, to keep away, to avoid contact. It's a command that he's giving us here. All right? In other words, there are some things Christians must keep away, not do. And in case you think that this is being legalistic, some things you can do, some things you don't do, this is a perfect command during this season of COVID-19. Everybody in this world, including Singapore, has taken extraordinary measures to keep people away from the virus. You know, most people don't want to catch it. The virus is not good. We've seen what it's done. You know, it can ultimately kill people. These few days, we have seen, you know, the death toll continues to rise in Singapore. All right. Thank God that it is still low here, 17 now, I believe. But here, one consequence of that is that we have to keep our distance from one another. It is a secondary thing because primarily we want to avoid the virus. That's why we keep our social distance. All right. Now, and the government has enacted a slew of legislation that if you do not keep the 1 meter distance, if you don't wear the mask and all that, you'll be fined. Now, do you tell an individual now, who is going out on the streets, all right, if he's wearing the mask, that he's legalistic? Something that he must wear when he goes out is a mask, and you say, hey, why are you so legalistic? No, right? I mean, we say we do it because we want to what? Avoid the virus. So there are some things that I have chosen not to do, not to get involved in, because it may lead me to sin. All right? Are you going to call me legalistic? Are you going to call a non-Christian who says, okay, you know, look, I'm just choosing not to do this because I know I have a propensity for this, so I'm just not going to do it totally and all that. You say, why are you so legalistic? You see, we are so busy keeping away from coronavirus, COVID-19, are we as busy keeping away from sin? Fleshly lust. That's what Peter is saying here. All right? And there are some things I want to avoid because I do not want to catch this virus of sin. All right? And we shouldn't just be so, you know, quick to say, oh, you're being legalistic. Wear this, don't wear that, and all that. Well, now you have to wear a mask, right? Are you being legalistic wearing a mask? Okay? So my question is, do you take extraordinary measures to abstain from what Peter is telling us to abstain here as you are right now abstaining from the virus? Okay, so Peter says here, abstain from fleshly lust. The word lust is a neutral word. It means passion. It just means desire. It can be good desire, bad desire, depending on the context. But here, obviously, we know that it means a negative thing. All right. It is fleshly lust or fleshly passion or passions of the flesh and so on. Actually, this is the second time Peter uses this word lust in chapter 1, verse 14. He says, as obedient children, not fashioning yourself to the former lust of your ignorance. Again, negative desire. All right. The word flesh is the weakness that is in all of us. We flesh. Paul tells us, 7 and 8, it is nothing good in us. Go with our whole life and so on. Okay. And Peter uses this word flesh often also. Chapter 1, verse 24, all flesh is as grass. Chapter 3, verse 18, Christ also once suffered for sin, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. Chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, for as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourself likewise with the same mind, for he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that you and I should no longer live the rest of our time in the flesh to the lust of men, but to the will of God. All right, I think that's a very good cross-reference. Chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, to connect to chapter 2 and verse 12 here. All right, so once again, what's helpful about Peter's instruction here is that he's writing to believers. You think that, you know, something is wrong with you because you struggle with flesh, well, be encouraged, because Peter is writing to believers who have the permanent indwelling of the Holy Spirit, and they continue to struggle with your flesh. And I tell you, it's going to be a lifelong struggle to your grave, but you don't stop fighting against the flesh. We'll talk about that later on. Now, probably the first thing that comes to your mind when we talk about fleshly lust is sexual immorality, sexual sins. And it certainly does include that. I read the disturbing article on a Christian website that says that during this lockdown, some pornographic content were made freely available. You know, you used to have to pay for it, and now it is made freely available. That is disastrous. All right? This is where, you know, COVID-19 lockdown can destroy people. They are in the privacy of their living, of their bedroom, maybe doing their work and so on. And then they're on their computer the whole day long and they're tempted by this kind of thing. All right? I'm really not so concerned that, you know, Christian people will get COVID-19 here in Singapore. I'm very glad that the local transmission has been going down. But I am very concerned about the virus called the lust of the flesh destroying our people. All right. I think it is easier to recover from COVID-19 in most cases than to recover from pornographic addiction. And I'm not singling out anyone. All right. Statistics says up to 80 to 90% of men and an increasing number of women struggle with pornography. All right. If you feel that you are struggling with pornography, all right, you are probably in the majority. Actually, you are in the majority. I know that for a fact. And you need accountability, all right? These kind of things don't just go away, because in this case, we will apply this principle. The strength of the sin is in the secrecy. Is don't tell anybody. That is where you continue to struggle in your sin. It is more addictive than cocaine and heroin. All right, and I've talked about this in the past, so you know, I just cannot talk enough about this. You know, think about who you can go to for help and get regular accountability. I read an article on the Covenant Eyes website. This man was testimony. He got involved in pornography at age 12, and it took him 30 years to really, and he's a married man and all that. It was having a strain on his marriage and all that. He was in it for 30 years. And even he got Covenant Eye software, a company program and so on. Got an accountability partner, fully keeping accountable. He still fell and all. Eventually today he's free of that sin. But that's what you need. It's not so easy to get rid of it, all right? You think about someone recovering from drug addiction, all right? And, you know, they have been four times in the drug rehabilitation center, you know, seven times in and out of a halfway house and so on. Well, sin of pornography, same thing, all right? People fall, all right? Find accountability. But there are a whole range of other fleshly lusts. For example, Peter in chapter 2, verse 1, mentions putting away malice and gall, which is deceit, and hypocrisies and envy and slander. All right, these are the lusts of the flesh. All right, other sins include pride. And I was thinking, about this as I listened to a message on Monday. If there's anything that COVID-19 has taught us, is that we ought to be humble people. After all, as believers, we know, we can do nothing to enter the kingdom of God. So why do we think that after we are saved, it all depends on us? The world has this phrase. The world says, if it is to be, it is up to me. Well, you don't find that phrase in the Bible. If it is to be, it is up to God, because God is sovereign. He's the one that causes all things to happen. And that means that our first instinct and priority is to bring our burden to the Lord rather than doing something about it, making it happen. Now, once again, I'm not saying that we sit on the couch, lace around the whole day and say, look, I'll let God handle this. You know, I'm not going to do anything about it. No. That's not what we're saying here. We are saying that, okay, how do you know that you are truly depending on God and that you are humbly depending on God? It's first of all, you go to the Lord in prayer. you cry out to God. You cast all your cares upon Him and you say, Lord, give me wisdom for this. Rather than the first thing you do is to whip out your phone, you WhatsApp someone, you call someone because you're trying to make it happen. No. So how do you know that you're humbly depending on God? Is the first thing you do is pray. First thing you do is pray. All right. It shows that, in your heart, you know who is in charge, who is in control, and you give it to God. You draw your strength and your vitality from God, rather than, I'm in a busy season of life, so I stop my devotion, I stop my prayer to God. Most busy season is when you need the Bible the most. It's when you need God the most. But we show we don't depend on God when we put all these things aside. Like, only people with a lot of free time can do devotion. It's a luxury. I don't have that luxury right now. No. you don't put away your devotion. You know, that is when you need your devotion. That is when you need the Word of God. That's when you need prayer. People who are humble, all right, displays their humility by increasing their prayer time, increasing their devotion to the Lord during times of greatest need. And you would agree that this is a time of greatest need, right? All right, so, but notice here that Peter says that this fleshly lust wars against our soul. Sometimes, you know, these desires are so strong, you know, that Peter uses images of warfare to describe it. You know, we abstain from fleshly lust because they are our enemies seeking to destroy us. Believers, we have three. We have three enemies: the world, Satan, and the flesh. That is why, even if you hide in the cave, all right, you will still sin. You have your flesh. You cannot run from your flesh. Wherever you run to, your flesh is there. You carry your flesh with you. Your flesh is an enemy seeking to destroy you. I once attended a public function, and an unbelieving person, nice gentleman, when he learned that I was a pastor, he asked me what was the most challenging thing about being a pastor. You know, that is a great question. You know, most Christians don't even ask me the question, but an unbeliever asked me the question. And you know what my response to that person is? The most challenging thing being a pastor is dealing with myself. Myself. He responded with a puzzled look, but I think you know what I mean by this answer. We are at war against COVID-19, and during wartime, nothing is normal. Everything is disrupted. It is helpful for us to be reminded to maintain a wartime mentality throughout our Christian life. I fight my flesh every day. Paul describes it this way. He says, I die daily. All right, my greatest difficulty, my greatest challenge is not dealing with the flock or with what whoever or whatever and all that. My greatest challenge is dealing with myself, my flesh. It rears its ugly head every day, all the time through the day. And it is a fight to the end. All right, so now, fighting this coronavirus, not with guns and bombs, right? Fights tells us nothing is normal, just like in a physical war, nothing is normal. All right. We shouldn't be lost. We have any kind of a peacetime mentality. No, it's always war. It's war against the devil, it's war against the world, it is war against the flesh. You think about the sins in your own life that you still struggle with and that you have been struggling with literally your entire life. Isn't it humbling to know that after all these years, you are still struggling with them? Doesn't it mean that you have to humbly depend on God for grace to help you with these sins? It is a fight to the end. Until the end, when you draw your final breath on this earth, you are still fighting against the lust of the flesh. Don't ever stop fighting against it. It is like, you know, you want cancer, you kill the cancer cells. It's our lifelong mission here on this earth, is to do this. All right, so from the internal of our own lust, our own passion, that now we are going to be looking at what Peter is going to say to the external conduct here. And once again, the conduct arises from a heart given to God, to purity, and not to the flesh. And so here, so negatively stated, abstain from fleshly lust, but now positively stated, we are to conduct ourselves honorably. And once again, the word conversation means conduct or behavior. In fact, Peter likes to use this word a lot in this passage. We saw that in chapter 1, verse 15, referring to the holiness of life required by Christians. He used it in chapter 1, verse 18, referring to the evil ways of life from which we have been delivered by Christ. he will use it again in chapter 3, 1 and 2 to describe godly behavior of wise and the godly lives of those suffering as believers in chapter 3, verse 16. All right, so he uses this word regularly, often. All right, this word conversation or conduct or behavior. All right, so once again, Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 to 16, our Lord says we are the light of the world. We are to let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works, glorify our Father which is in heaven. In other words, such thing as a private Christian. I hear some people say, oh, I don't wear my Christianity on my sleeve. But where do you hide it? Bible already says, you know, a city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Why do you want to, you know, hide your Christianity, you know? And all that. And there's really two aspects to what Peter is calling for believers to do. He's telling believers to have a good testimony when he talks about honorable conduct. Good testimony. James uses the word honest. Honest means honorable, good, it means beautiful, it means a good reputation. This means students, on your tests and exams, a big employee, finding out what you need to do and so on, take initiative, all right? It is second term, you know, there's a second aspect by which this, you know, what we're talking about here that we are supposed to do is that we are to play good deeds, which is what Peter says here, that they may see your good works. So, good. But you are, do these good deeds. And once you know, you look at what Christians have done throughout history, Christians have all been on the front line building hospitals, education, building schools, orphanages, famine relief, poverty relief, disaster relief. Christian pastors are the North Koreans escaped to South Korea. That's no secret, all right? You can watch a number of documentaries on that kind of thing. They operate pregnancy centers, you know, to an abortion clinic and so on. But yesterday, this is an extraordinary thing. I just watched this documentary featuring this man, but Eubank go his three children, he's 7 years old, you know his parents Thailand, the
he grew up, you know, as a missionary kid in Thailand. He always felt that, you know, God wanted him to be a soldier, so he enrolled in military school in the States and became a commissioned officer and became a Special Forces Army Ranger. All right? He was in the Army Ranger for 10 years. He actually met his wife, challenging her to climb up Mount Rainier in Washington State, one of the highest peaks in North America, so she made it, and he said, you know, will you marry me, because I'm qualified, you can rub it out the way I do. And then a few, you know, shortly after that, his dad, called him and said, look, you know, you need to come here because there is the Burma army are fighting these minority tribes in the mountains, the Kachin people, you know, need you to come and help them. You know, because these people are now displaced, they are all flooding into Thailand and so on. So he went there to help them. So this was, you know, when he was newly married, no kids and so on. But when kids came along, he decided that they should join in the mission. So the kids all grew up in this battlefield as he's helping to provide humanitarian aid, train these tribal people in Burma to take care of the wounded and so on. So he doesn't get involved in the fighting, but he trained these men and women as well and all that. And many of these people came to Christ. And then, so he was training them for 20 years. And then, after that, when ISIS started attacking the Kurds in Iraq, he got, you know, he got people contacted him and said, would you come and help us here, you know, with what we're doing here? Remember, he is an army ranger. He's trained in special forces and so on. Even though he's in his 50s, he looks like, I think he can do more push-up than someone who is in their 20s. All right, you look at how fit he is, and you look at all his biceps and triceps and so on. But he hit the call. He went to the front line in the northern part of Iraq, in this place called Mosul, which was the historic name was Nineveh. You know Nineveh. It was a place that that Jonah went to. All right, and several individuals they worked with got killed on the front line. The fight in Iraq is so different from the fight in Burma. He even brought several Burmese men with him. One of them got killed. All right, so, you know, but instead of that, and he brought his whole family there. But here's a man, you know, who is showing the love of Christ. And really, I think the Lord has prepared him for the kind of work that he does. You know, as an army ranger and so on, he's on the front line, he's fearless, his wife is fearless as well, and he trained his children to be fearless as well, and when the documentary interviewed his children, they're all very grateful for what their parents are doing for them and so on, you know. They are not entitled, they don't feel self-entitled and all that, you know, but they are very grateful for the experiences that they have had. So this group is called Free Burma Rangers. You can go online, you can Google them. In fact, there's a documentary streaming on Facebook. You can Google that, and you can actually watch the documentary. Maybe I'll give you the link later on. Amazing thing that he's doing. People coming to Christ. He before he even rush out, he will pray. You know, and one thing that they do is they document everything. They will video camera. They will record everything as much as possible. So there's always, some of these men are cameramen, they want to document what they're seeing, broadcast it to the world so that the world can see what is happening there, alright? So some of the scenes are pretty gruesome, but you know, that is the reality of war, alright? He would pray for these people, pray for God to save them, you know, show them the love of Christ. But here's an example of good deeds, alright? I'm just giving you an illustration. I'm not saying that you should rush out and join his army and all that, but I think that is great inspiration for us as believers to see someone on the front line, you know, doing these things for Christ and seeing people saved as well. Now, what is the reason? Let's end with this. What's the reason for why we do what we do? Well, first of all, you realize that Peter says we may be slandered. In verse 12, Peter says, having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers. That's what? That's slander. And once again, here's the expectation. The unbelieving world may speak evil against you as evildoers. They may hate your guts. Not because, you know, you are some evil person, but simply because you're a Christian. You may ask, well, why would they do that? And actually, Peter answered this question later on in this book. Look at chapter 4, verse 3 and 4. Chapter 4, verse 3 and 4, Peter says, for in time past of our life, before you were saved, all right, it may suffice us to have done these things, the will of the Gentiles. Before we were saved, this is what we do. What do we do? We walk in lasciviousness. We walk in lust. We drink until we get drunk, excess of wine. We are involved in these partings, the banquetings, and abominable idolatries. Before you were saved, and some of you can allude to this, you just did whatever you want to do. You know, whatever you feel like doing, whatever gives you pleasure, that's what you do. You indulge in those things. Now, verse 4, wherein they think it strange that you are no longer running with them, you are no longer running with the same crowd to the same excess of riot. And because they say, hey, what happened to you? You suddenly became Holy Joe. You don't drink with us. You don't go to karaoke with us. You don't revel with us and so on. You don't go to, you know, parties and drunkenness and so on with us. You know, who are you now? And guess what? Look at what this verse says. They are speaking evil of you. You used to do this, now you no longer do this, and they think it's strange, and they start to slander you. It is because you are not doing the kind of things that they are doing. And folks, let me just, I think sometimes because we do not want to feel rejected by the world, and we are tempted to, okay, let me do this with you. We are tempted to, you know, to go to the disco party. We are tempted to go to the pubs. We are tempted to do the things that the world does for entertainment and for stress relief. And we are tempted to go back to the ways of the world. And Peter is saying, don't do that. Accept the fact that they will mock you, they will slander you just because you're a Christian. If there's anything, you can be the nicest Christian in the world, do everything right, and they will still hate you because you are a Christian. Alright? Later on in chapter 2, verse 15, Peter will say, for so it is the will of God that with all well-doing you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. Alright? Chapter 3, verse 15, having a good conscience so that when you are slandered, and you will be slandered, alright? People will say bad things about you. They will write bad things about you. Those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. Alright? So once again, there's a big danger here. We need to do what we can do to stop the world from maligning us. So we join them in these things of the flesh. No. That is a wrong way to think. That's a wrong way to act. The only way you can stop them from speaking evil of you is for you to go back to doing what you used to do as an unsaved person. Finally, we thought you became a religious nut. We thought you became a religious fanatic. You know, welcome, join us back. Going back to Vanity Fair, like John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress describes. No. Don't do that. Don't ever do that. All right? Now, if they have eyes to see, we are told here that they may see they will behold your good works. All right? And if they are going to be honest enough, all right, even though they may still hate you, all right, they will still, if they are, nobody is unbiased, right? Everybody sees things, you know, in a biased way and so on. Even then, if they are going to be honest enough, they will say, yeah, you know, he is a good person. They cannot fault you for that. You continue with your good works. If they say, oh, but this Christian, he cheats on his exam, then you have destroyed your testimony, right? Now, notice what they will do out at the end. This is the purpose of this. So that you do all these good works, good conduct, so that they would glorify God in the day of visitation. And obviously, your question is, what is the day of visitation? Is it when the pastor comes and visit you in your home? Is it when you go check things door to door? No. That's not what we're thinking about here. All right? This term could most probably refer to the last day when God comes to judge. So these people will glorify God in the day that they are judged. But there are good reasons to believe that Peter is talking about salvation here. The way God is most glorified is when people are most satisfied in Him, to borrow a phrase from John Piper. And the only way they can be most satisfied is when they put their trust in Him and Him alone. Okay, this term is used. Acts 15:14, Simeon had declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles to take out of them a people for His name. God visited the Gentiles to take out a people for His name. Luke 1:68, where Simeon in the temple, when the parents of Jesus brought him to the temple, he prayed this, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for He has visited and redeemed His people." So the visitation is always, you know, in connection with salvation. All right? So unbelievers see the good works of believers, and that in part leads to their salvation, and God gets glory in the last day. Let me leave you with some questions for you to think about. Okay? Questions to ponder about. What temptations are you facing to want to fit in with the world so that you will feel more accepted? All right? Do you feel the mockery of the world? There are people who make fun of you. you know, or they just simply hate you because what you are choosing not to, you know, go up to the pub with them on Friday night, and you know, they say, oh, look at this holy Joe, no life one, man, this guy, you know, you just want to go home and Bible study or whatever, or small group or whatever it is. You know. Well, let them say it, but you continue to love them, and you show the love of Christ to them. All right, but what kind of temptation do you feel like giving in? Do they dress a certain way that you feel that you should? Well, you want to dress to fit in, you know, you don't want to be living in the Victorian era, you don't want to dress a certain way and all that. I told you, right? You know, is wearing a mask a legalistic thing? So why would dressing in a modest way be a legalistic thing? You know, so that you will protect the eyes of people who have been infected by the virus of pornography. Do you feel that, let's join them one day at the disco, is no problem. Is it called disco or pub? I'm not sure what they call it nowadays. Clubbing, right? It's a word that they use nowadays. Let's go and club with them now, you know, after army and all that, join my army friends, go clubbing and all that. You know, that seems to be an in thing to do and all that. I don't drink so much, I don't drink anything, I'm drunk and all that. Is that a kind of temptation that you feel that you want to give in to the world, all right? But you feel more accepted? Or do you feel that, you know, you need to keep up with the Joneses, all right? You know, look at my peers. They are all achieving at this level already. Look at me. I'm still living in my, you know, small apartment in HDB and all that. They are all already moving onward and all that. You know, their car are getting bigger and bigger. Do you feel the pressure and the temptation to keep up with them? You know, I'm already, coming to 42. All my friends have already gone far, far ahead. You know, I can't even see the dust, you know, on the track that you leave behind already. All right, don't compare yourself with what your peers are having. Number two, what fleshly passions are the Lord dealing with you in your heart? All right, you know, I mentioned to you, you know, I'm not so afraid that you'll get coronavirus. I'm more afraid that you catch the passions of the flesh, you know, and in the privacy of your own room as you are working from home or studying from your home or whatever. You know, can you use some accountability? Who can you ask for help? And then ask, you know, download, install, you know, accountability software, Covenant Eyes or whatever. I do. Guess what? I don't trust myself. I don't even trust myself, you know, because I have the flesh in me. Do you trust yourself? You know, are you that, you know, have you achieved that level where you say, you know, what do you trust me? I don't even trust myself. You know, I do trust you, but, you know, nobody should trust themselves because they have the flesh they are dealing with. I know, you know, what my flesh is up to no good. Number three, ask the Holy Spirit to search your heart regarding your conduct among your classmates, your soldiers, you know, if you're in NS or your colleagues. What kind of reputation do you hold among them? You know, have you displayed unblameable conduct? You know, have you displayed a good testimony? And then think about what good works can you do to lead others to glorify God. We are talking about a Christianity that is lived out in the public, that is outward. Remember, now we are moving into the outward sphere as pilgrims. All right, and here is a temptation for us during this COVID-19. I talked about last week. You know, to curve in among myself, within me. Of my studies and, you know, my work and my this and my that and my problems and all that. But, you know, and I say, depressed people are the people who always curve inside themselves. What about others? What about others that they ought to be reaching out to? We live in a world where, you know, our social media and our handphones and all that are helping us to curve into ourselves. When we have free time, we don't reach out to others. When we have free time, we play computer games. When we have free time, we don't call other people. We watch YouTube. When we have free time to reach out to other people, we don't communicate with them, you know, or to reach out to them with the gospel. We scroll on Instagram. You know, this is the world that we live in, and the danger is something that I'm pointing out, in our isolation with 4 more weeks to go. All right. So I want to leave you with this encouragement. You know, look, if you can conduct yourself honorably, if you can do good deeds, it is the Holy Spirit working in you. And you can, because the Holy Spirit, if you are a believer this morning, the Holy Spirit is living in you. and we need to depend. We cannot do this in our own strength. You know? So let me just tighten my belt, gird my teeth, right? You know, grip my fist, and let me just do these good things. No, no, no. You do it in your own strength, you won't do it for long. You do any supernatural thing in your own strength, you will not do it for long. Just mark it down. I've seen a lot of those cases. All right? So depend on the Lord, not in your own strength. Pray to Him. That is what humility looks like. Go to Him in prayer. If you're in a stressful time, increase the dose of scripture reading. Increase your prayer time. All right? Don't neglect these things just because you are busy. That is, once again, a mark of depending on your own strength. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that even as we have, as we study it, that you will help us to live out the truth that we have learned today. All these truths from here on out will be very practical. So we are exhorting one another to live out what we have learned, to be people marked by our honorable conduct and our good deeds, so that even though the world will speak evil of us, they will observe what we have done and give you glory by coming to faith in Lord Jesus Christ. So I pray that you give us the opportunity to open our mouth to tell people of the good news and lead us in this way, for in Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, so let's end with this. New Year's hymn written by John Bunyan. God love John Bunyan, you know. He who would valiant be a pilgrim, all right? So here is our prayer. We can end this way. May God give you courage, help you to be a valiant Christian in this world that we're living in, that you would truly be marked out to be a man or woman, boy and girl, with good conduct and good deeds. So let's sing this closing hymn together.
Say.